I've been there for over 2 years with about 4,000 hours of flight. I've been on multiple deployments and training operations and have served the Air Force, both active duty and now as a Nebraska Guardsman for a combination of about 15 and a half years. I'm a father of five, and like everyone that's speaking with me today, for the most part, filed for a religious accommodation as well. There are two very important loopholes that I want to bring up this afternoon regarding this bill. The first one is that many servicemen and women who have stayed in through the mandate have had their careers severely damaged regarding this vaccine mandate. And currently, the protection that LB 642 provides is very limited in scope. The second is that many people got out before making it to the denial stage of the religious accommodation similar to major capacity, and therefore were not discharged, but rather separated of their own volition. With regards to the people whose careers have been hampered, not severely halted, the bill states that, and I'm paraphrasing here, that any member who is prevented from training, promotion, or career advancement opportunities before the pandemic should now be given the opportunity for these things. The bill needs to be amended to say before, during, and after the pandemic. And furthermore, what the bill does not say does not consider that even if these members were allowed to go back and accomplish training or get promoted, it does not take into account the fact that their careers are now about a year or two delayed compared to their peers. In future career progression opportunities for follow-on assignments, this will leave a proverbial black eye on the record, not to mention all the negative stipulations and connotations that will still follow them around. They will be remembered by many people as those who did not fall in line. And this is a very difficult obstacle to overcome. The bill needs to sharply state that their records need to be backdated to the original normal timing of career progression. Furthermore, this bill does not make any mention of financial or monetary reimbursement for these men and women. For those who are delayed promotion, that means money in their pocket that they could have received. Perhaps the most frustrating aspect of all is that these men and women paid money out of their own pockets to try and keep level with their surrounding peers. As an example, the Army was not paying for unvaccinated members to travel for training necessary for career progression, but they were allowing unvaccinated members to travel if they paid for it out of their own pocket. Effectively, this created an unfair advantage for career progression and required men and women to pay expenses out of pocket in an unjust manner. Secondly, the bill does not take into account those members who separated of their own accord from the oppression they were receiving. The problem with the bill is that it does not capture this aspect of the mandate. I will fully tell you right now that in the state of Nebraska, it's likely that five times more people flat out left the service as a result of a mandate than those who were actually discharged. To my knowledge, I have a lot of great connections with people all over the state and Army and Air Guard. I don't know of one person that's actually been discharged in the state of Nebraska. I could be wrong about that, but a lot of people have left. Adam is just one of the many. Senior Master Sergeant Jerry Bimicheski worked in the front office of Colonel Williams, Wing Commander of the 155th Aerial Refueling Squadron. After daily being harassed in the front office with Mr. Pierce and spending close to many hours on the phone with Colonel Williams, trying to manipulate her to get the vaccine, she ended her 25-year career as a senior master sergeant who had actually been selected to be a chief master sergeant, which was one of her dreams. Major Aaron Karpasek is a tanker instructor pilot in the same wing under the impressive leadership of Colonel Williams. He's set to separate April 5th after 12 years of service. He has over 2,000 hours, 400 sorties, and 4 deployments. And his only reason for leaving was due to the vaccine mandate and the pressure he received during that. There's a couple other examples there. But the mandate created a certain type of anxiety in people that is difficult to confront. For me personally, I have five children. I have to look them in the eyes every night. I have to confront the fact for a while that I may not have the same job that I needed to provide a meal for them every night. These people all served in a time period where equal opportunity complaints were being silenced and dismissed behind closed doors. Complaints against commanders were being brushed under the rug and concealed. And fair treatment was a pipe dream. I personally am fortunate enough to have had great leadership throughout this that was supportive of me. And I know that when the time came to it, they would have had to follow Air Force guidance and discharging when that part took place. So thank you for your time and my time. And I appreciate your service out today.
Thank you for your testimony and thank you for your service. Questions? question, Senator Ringel.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Downey. And so my dad was in the military, but we weren't raised in a military family. So forgive me if I'm asking you a very dumb question. So I apologize in advance. But in your service, is there any other area where you can be given a religious accommodation? Are you aware of?
There's many things you can get a religious accommodation for. So some religions have, beard requests as an example, and shaving waiver, where they can grow a beard for their religion. So vaccine is just a small piece of pie for that. Is that what you're asking?
It is, and then, are you required to take other vaccines?
Oh, yes, yes,
like,
absolutely.
If you deploy somewhere, do you have to get malaria treatments?
Yes, okay. So there's a whole host of different vaccination requirements for different locations that you're deployed to.
And can you get a religious exemption for any of those vaccines?
You can apply for them, certainly. So it's a religious accommodation is not guaranteed. So you basically have to request that you will be accommodated. Sometimes they will not accommodate you, which was the case for about 99% of us that made the request to Air Force One.
And then, I guess this is a tough question. Are there any orders that you can refuse to follow as a member of the National Guard?
Not to my knowledge, no. Yeah, we would be required to follow the vaccine mandate.